गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल. माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर संजय अग्रवाल. आई एम एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर इन इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग इन स्कूल ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द टॉपिक सोलर थर्मल टेक्नोलॉजीज. दिस सोलर थर्मल टेक्नोलॉजीज बेसिकली इज ए पार्ट ऑफ द कोर्स OEY002 विच कम्स अंडर द प्रोग्राम CETM, दैट इज सर्टिफिकेट इन एनर्जी टेक्नोलॉजी एंड मैनेजमेंट. This Certificate in Energy Technology and Management have four courses: OEY001, that is Energy Resources and Conversion Process; second is OEY002, Renewable Energy Technology and Their Uses; and OEY003, Energy Management, Audit and Conservation; and fourth one is OEY004. So today I am going to discuss course OEY002, Block 1. So as the topic is solar thermal technologies, so in solar thermal technologies there are different topic comes. That is, we will discuss the technology which is based on the solar thermal, like solar cooker, solar water collector, solar air collector and solar still. Before to discuss the these technologies, we have to understand some basic of the solar, like solar radiation and radiation characteristic of material. Then we have to discuss the heat transfer characteristic of surface, Kirchhoff's law of radiation, type of solar radiation, and what the different mode of heat transfer. So first of all, I am going to discuss about the solar radiation and radiation characteristic of material. As you know, all the solar energy devices depend upon the electromagnetic radiation emitted from the sun and striking the earth surface. As solar radiation passes through the atmosphere, some of it is absorbed, some is scattered, and rest is reflected by the different things like air molecules effect, water vapor, cloud, dust, pollutants, forest fire, and volcanoes. Now I have to understand and that what is the heat transfer characteristic of surface. Basically, as you know, thermal radiations are electromagnetic radiation. The speed of thermal radiation is related to the wavelength and frequency by the following equation, like C is equal to lambda nu, where C is speed of light. That means speed of light and speed of electromagnetic radiation which comes in form of short wavelength is the same. That is 3.8 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. And lambda is a wavelength of the radiation. It is denoted in meter, and nu is a frequency of the radiation per second. As you know, the electromagnetic radiation behave like waves and also like particles. As particles, electromagnetic wave called photons of energy, is the energy of this photon is given by E is equal to h nu, where E is energy of the photons in the joule, and h is a Planck constant, and value of this Planck constant is 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second, and nu is the frequency of the radiation. This photon of energy is responsible to create the electrical energy from the solar cell, as I have discussed in the previous lecture. Here you can see in the diagram that when a beam of thermal radiation is incident on the surface of the body, then some of it may get reflected away from the surface, some of it may get absorbed by the body, and some of it may get transmitted through the body. So here you can see the equation, that is alpha plus rho plus tau equal to 1, where alpha is absorptivity, that means ability to absorb the solar radiation, that is called absorptivity. And rho is a reflectivity. Reflective means ability to reflect the solar radiation when strike to the surface or anybody. And tau is a transmittivity, means ability to transmit the solar radiation by the this medium, maybe the glass, maybe the any medium. So here you can see that summation of the fraction of radiation absorbed by the surface, plus fraction of the radiation reflected by the surface, plus fraction of the radiation transmitted through the surface is equal to 1. most of the solid objects are opaque. Opaque means what? Which are not transparent. And that is which are not transparent, that means transmittivity of that particular object is zero. If a body absorbs all the incoming radiation, and such type of body is called black body. So because it is a black body and this object is opaque, that means transmittivity is zero. And if you are assuming that reflectivity is also zero, that means all the radiation coming from the sun will be absorbed. That means alpha plus rho plus tau is equal to 1. That means value of tau and value of rho is 0. That means alpha equal to 1. The radiation characteristic of surface depend not only on the surface properties but also on the wavelength and direction of the radiation. The emissive power, that is denoted by E suffix B, of a black body is expressed by the Stefan Boltzmann law, and this expression can be denoted as E suffix B is equal to sigma multiplied T to the power 4, where sigma is Stefan Boltzmann constant, and value of this sigma is 5.67 into 10 to the power minus 8 watt per meter square K to the power 4, and T is the temperature in degree Kelvin. Now you have to understand what is the emissivity of the surface. So emissivity of surface can be defined as ratio of total emissive power E of a real surface to the total emissive power E B of a black body is called emissivity. It is denoted by epsilon. So epsilon is equal to what? E upon EV. So E is what? Emissive power, and EV is total emissive power. The emissivity of surface is a function of the following three parameters. First is surface temperature, second is wavelength of incidence radiation, and third is direction of the incident of radiation. Now another basic that we have to understand, that is Kirchhoff's law. This Kirchhoff's law is of the radiation. The Kirchhoff's law is related to the radiation. The Kirchhoff's law of radiation states that monochromatic emissivity is equal to the monochromatic absorbivity for any surface when in thermal equilibrium with its surrounding. This may be expressed as epsilon delta T lambda T equal to alpha lambda T, where epsilon lambda T is monochromatic emissivity at given lambda and temperature. Similarly, alpha is absorbivity at given wavelength and temperature. Now we have to understand solar radiation on a surface. What are the different factors on which solar radiation depends? So there are different factors on which solar radiation depends. First is geographic location. Second is the time of the day. That means solar radiation, as you can understand, at 9 a.m. solar radiation is something like, it may be the 400 watt per meter square. At 10 a.m. it may be 550 or 600 watt per meter square. At 1100, and 12, and during the noon time it will be the maximum solar radiation between 12 to 1. It may be the 900 watt per meter square, or it may be the 1000 watt per meter square. And second is season. Season is each of the four division of a year, like spring, summer, autumn and winter. And next is a local landscape, and last is a local weather. So what is the weather? Weather is a short-term state of the atmosphere at a specific time and place, including the temperature, humidity, cloud cover and wind, etc. The another term is also that affect the solar radiation, that is a climate. Climate is how the atmosphere behave over a relatively long period of time. So these are all are the different factor on which amount of solar radiation depends, that is geographical location, time of the day, season, local landscape, local weather. Now what are the causes, the hourly variation of the solar radiation reaching the earth? The rotation of the earth is responsible for hourly variations in sunlight. It is interesting to note that in the early morning and the late afternoon, the sun is low in the sky. Its ray travel longer through the atmosphere than at noon, when the sun is at its highest point. There are some key points that you should remember. First one is the sun strikes the surface at different angle, ranging from 0 degree just above the horizon to the 90 degree directly overhead due to the nearly round shape of the earth. So when angle is a 90 degree, that means sun is directly above the earth. That means at this time you will get the maximum solar radiation. Second is earth revolves around the sun in elliptical orbit, and it is closer to the sun during the part of the year. You can understand, suppose this is a earth and sun is moving. That means when earth moves like this, in this way, so when, because it is elliptical, so it, when a position it comes here, that means distance between earth and sun is minimum. That means at that time you will get the maximum solar radiation. Third is earth is nearer the sun when it is summer in the southern hemisphere and winter in the northern hemisphere. You should also know what is the temperature of the sun. Sun of temperature is nearly about 5760 degree Kelvin. These are the points that you should remember for the further calculation. Now we have to understand what are the different type of solar radiation. So solar radiation can be classified as beam radiation or direct radiation, diffuse radiation and global radiation. So first of all, we have to understand what is a beam radiation. Beam radiation is also called direct radiation. The radiation received by the earth without any change in the direction is referred as beam radiation or direct radiation. You can see in the figure. Second is a diffuse radiation. The diffuse radiation is received by the earth from all the direction. The radiation may change their direction due to the scattering from the dust particles, cloud, etc. while passing through the atmosphere. Diffuse radiation do not have a unique direction. That means whenever the radiation coming from the sun and this radiation will pass through the cloud, and passing through the cloud it will come to the surface. That means that radiation is not coming directly to the earth or the surface. That means this type of radiation is called diffuse radiation. Here you can understand by the figure. Third is global radiation, and this is also called solar insolation. So summation of the diffuse radiation plus direct radiation is called global radiation, and this is also called insolation. Insolation can be defined as total amount of solar radiation per unit area per day reaching on a part of earth is called insolation. It is also called incident solar radiation. In the figure you can see that from the sun direct radiation is coming to the surface, and another radiation is coming, first radiation is going to the cloud, and then from the cloud it is coming to the surface. That is called diffuse radiation. So when you are adding this direct radiation and diffuse radiation, it is called global radiation. Another term that you must know, that is irradiance. Irradiance can be defined as the rate at which radiation fall on the surface per unit area is called irradiance, and it is denoted in watt per meter square. So whenever we talk that intensity in solar radiation, all are the same. That means irradiance or solar intensity is defined in watt per meter square. Here you can see that terrestrial and extraterrestrial region. Here you can see from the sun and earth, three regions are divided. One is a extraterrestrial region, second is atmosphere, third is a terrestrial region. In extraterrestrial, there is oxygen, ozone, carbon dioxide, water, carbon monoxide and dust. So what happens here? Whenever because rays come in from the electromagnetic radiation from the sun, this electromagnetic radiation is the basically short wavelength, and this short wavelength have a maximum energy, because as you know that E is equal to h upon lambda. That means short wavelength, that means this energy is inversely proportional to the lambda. That means this short wavelength have a maximum energy, and this electromagnetic radiation have such energy that it can penetrate to the atmosphere. When this electromagnetic radiation passes through the extraterrestrial region, it is absorbed by the oxygen, by the ozone, carbon monoxide and water, carbon monoxide and dust, and passing through the atmosphere, then it reaches to the surface of the earth. So this short wavelength is some of the this electromagnetic radiation which is in short wavelength absorbed by the earth. Some of them is reflected in form of the long wave radiation. So long wave radiation, basically as lambda is more, that means energy is less. That means because such electromagnetic radiation is absorbed by the sun, that means energy associated this short wavelength is absorbed by the earth, that means energy is reduced. So energy is reduced, so it is radiate in form of the long wave radiation, it doesn't have such energy that it can again pass through the atmosphere and to reach to the sun. That means what happens? This long wave radiation is not able to pass through the atmosphere, and this long wave radiation is responsible to increase the heat of the atmosphere. Basically, such effect is called greenhouse effect, right? So this greenhouse effect you can understand by the one example, like when you see whenever all the windows of the car is locked, that means solar radiation comes and it passes through the glass. This short wavelength is able to pass through the glass of the window, and then it is absorbed by the inner body of the car, and this electromagnetic radiation is absorbed by the inner part of the car, and then it transmits in form of the long wave radiation. And this long wave radiation is not able to pass through, come out through the window. That means that electromagnetic wave radiation, which is a long wave radiation, is responsible to increase the temperature of inside of the car. And this effect is basically greenhouse effect. Here you can notice that solar radiation outside earth is atmosphere is almost constant, and this is called solar constant. Solar constant is defined as radiation received per unit per second by surface of unit area held normal to the sun's ray at the near earth sun distance out the atmosphere. The value of solar constant is equal to the 1367 watt per meter square. So this solar constant is, as the name is indicating, it is a constant. So this value is always constant. Here now we have to understand what are the main component of solar radiation falling on the earth. So you can understand, as I have already explained, short wavelength, that is optical wavelength radiation from the sun, reaches the top of the atmosphere. Then cloud reflects 17% back into space. If earth gets more cloudy, more radiation will be reflected back and less will reach the surface. Now out of this, 8% is scattered backwards by the air molecules, and 6% is actually directly reflected off the surface back into the space. So the total reflectivity of earth is 31%, which is technically known as albedo. Now breakup of the remaining 69% of the incoming radiation that doesn't get reflected back, and this can be understand as 19% gets absorbed directly by the dust, ozone and water vapor in the upper atmosphere. This region is also called stratosphere and is heated by the absorbed radiation. 4% get absorbed by the cloud located in the troposphere. This is lower part of the earth atmosphere. The remaining 46% of sunlight, that is the incident on top of the Earth's atmosphere reaches the surface. So this is a breakup of the 69% of the incoming solar radiation that doesn't get reflected back. Now, solar radiation can be classified as ultraviolet, visible, and infrared. So ultraviolet radiation are the radiation which have less than 0.38 micrometer wavelength, approximately 7% of the solar radiation. Second is the visible. The wavelength of this visible solar radiation is from 0.38 to 0.78 micrometer. And this visible rays are the 47% of the solar radiation. And third is the infrared. Infrared radiation which have wavelength more than 0.78 micrometer, and this is a 46% of the solar radiation. So this visible solar radiation which comes under the short wavelength which reaches to the earth, that is a visible solar radiation. It is interesting to note that X-ray and extreme ultraviolet radiation are absorbed by the nitrogen, oxygen, and other atmospheric gases. Second, ozone absorbs ultraviolet radiation which have wavelength less than 0.4 micrometer, and water vapors absorb infrared radiation which have wavelength greater than 2.3 micrometer. Now here you can see the latitude and elevation of the some places in India, because whenever you have to calculate the value of the this beam radiation, diffuse radiation, or global radiation, then you must know the what is the latitude, what is the elevation. Because as I already explained in the previous lecture or in this coming session, whenever the PV module or solar collector, if you want to get the maximum solar radiation, it is faced toward the south and it is placed on the latitude of that particular city. So you must know what is the latitude of that particular city. So these latitudes are denoted in the table, like we are in Delhi. So the latitude of New Delhi is 28 degree and latitude of Kolkata is approximate 22 degree. So this is to have some idea what are the latitude of the different cities. Now we have to understand modes of the heat transfer. So heat can be transferred by three mechanisms. One is conduction, second is a convection, and third is radiation. So now we have to understand what is a conduction. Transfer of heat from one particle to the adjacent particle is known as conduction of heat. In solid, heat is transferred by process of conduction. In this process, the transfer of heat takes place through the adjacent molecules, and the amount of heat transferred through conduction can be calculated by following formula. That is K into A, where K is a heat transfer coefficient, A is area, and difference in temperature. That means heat, because as you know, it is a rule, heat always transfer from higher temperature to lower temperature, say just like a current. In the current always transfer from higher potential to lower potential. So this here thermal heat due to the conduction can be calculated by this formula. Now we have to understand some examples of the conduction. Whenever you iron the cloth, so heat associated in the base of the iron, and when you iron the cloth, this heat is transferred to the cloth by the conduction process. Second example we can understand, when an end of an iron rod is put over flame, then part of which is near to the flame is heated first, and heat is gradually transferred to the other end of the rod. This happens because particles of iron rod which are nearer to the flame receive the heat and transfer this to the adjacent particle. Subsequently, the adjacent particle transfer the heat to the next adjacent particle, and this process continue and heat reaches to the other end of the rod. Thus, heat transfer in solid take place through the conduction. Second mode is a convection. The transfer of heat because of movement of molecules of the medium by a mass transfer is called convection or convection of heat. The amount of heat transferred through the convection can be calculated by this formula Q is equal to Hc multiplied by area and difference of temperature. Here Ts is the temperature of the surface and Tf is a temperature of the fluid. This fluid may be the air, this fluid may be the water also. So, and here Hc is a heat transfer coefficient watt per meter square Kelvin, and A is the area in meter square, and temperature may be in the Kelvin or may be the centigrade, because it is a difference, so there is a no effect. And third, now another, you can understand the example of convection, how the convection happens in water. When water is heated in a container, the particles of water which are nearer to the source of heat get heated first, and because of heating they become light and rise in the water. The gap which is created because of rise of hot particles is filled by cold particles of water from the surrounding area. The cyclical movement in the fluid because of heating is called convection current. Now, as the convection happens in the water, similarly convection happens in the air. Air gets heated because of convection, same as water gets heated. Air nearer the source of heat gets heated and rise above. This leaves a gap which is filled by the colder air from the surrounding, and the convection current thus starts in air, which result in heating up of air. This phenomena you can see in your room in the summer condition. When AC is on, then sometime if you are standing on the bed, and you will feel that temperature nearer the roof is more in comparison to the temperature near the bed, because what happens, as it start to heat, it gets lighter and the molecules of this air goes up. So at the above side, upper side, it's the temperature of this air is more in comparison to the lower side. Now, third mode is a radiation, which is very interesting. Thermal radiation is generated by the emission of the electromagnetic waves. These waves carry away the energy from the emitting body. Radiation takes place through a vacuum or transparent medium, which can either be solid or liquid. Thermal radiation is the result of random motion of the molecules in the matter. Movement of charge, electrons and protons, is responsible for the emission of the electromagnetic radiation. How much heat transferred due to this radiation can be calculated by Stefan-Boltzmann law. And it is denoted by the P, where P is equal to E sigma A TR minus TC to the power 4. This TR is a room temperature and TC is the temperature of the another body. So this is denoted by the Stefan-Boltz law, and value of this I have explained in the previous slides. And there are some example of the radiation. First is a microwave radiation emitted in oven is an example of radiation. Every household have the microwave, and you see how the food is heated, and so this microwave work on the principle of radiation. Second is a ultraviolet wave rays coming from the sun is an example of radiation. And third is a responsible release of the alpha particles during the decaying of the uranium-238 into the thorium-234 is an example of radiation. Now, because we are going to discuss about the solar thermal technology, so there are different technology due to the solar. So first one is a solar cooker. As name is indicating, solar cooker, that means solar cooker are the device that use solar energy to cook food, is a solar cooker basically. Now, before to discuss the about the what is the construction and how food is cooked, first of all we have to understand what are the advantage of the solar cooker, right? So first advantage of solar cooker is what? There is no requirement of cooking gas or kerosene, electricity, coal or wood. because you don't require the gas, kerosene, electricity, that means you no need to spend the money on this, because this solar cooker work due to the solar, and solar energy is free. There means there is no money involved for this kerosene, electricity, coal or wood. That means it work due to the solar. And third is, food cooked in the solar cooker is nutritious. About 10 to 20% of the protein retention is more as compared to that in the conventional cooking. Vitamin retention is about 20 to 30% more, whereas vitamin A is retained 5 to 10% more when food is cooked in solar cooker. Another advantage is, solar cooking is pollution free and safe, because you are using the solar energy, basically non-conventional energy, it doesn't pollute. If you cook food by the electrical oven or by the gas, that means this pollute, because electricity pollutes some the carbon dioxide, similarly gas pollutes something. So that means solar doesn't pollute anything, that means solar cooking is pollution free and safe. Solar cooker come in various size based on the number of the family member. The size of the cooker can be chosen. All cooking activities like boiling, roasting can be done using a solar cooker. There are some disadvantage also of solar cooker. First is, adequate sunshine is required for cooking. If there is no sunshine, that means you cannot cook the food. For that, what you have to do? You have to make the hybrid solar cooker. That means when there is no sunshine, then this solar cooker be integrated by the electrical heater. That means at that time you can cook the food by the electricity, and when there is sun, then you can cook the food with of the solar mechanism. And it takes longer time to cook food than the conventional cooking method. So these are the disadvantages of the solar cooker. Now, there basically solar cooker can be classified in two types. One is a box type solar cooker, which is used for the household cooking, and second is concentrated type solar cooker. And this concentrated type solar cooker is used for the community cooking. In concentrated type solar cooker, which concentrate solar energy from a large surface to a smaller area to produce high temperature. Here you can see the box type solar cooker. So it is just like a hot box in which food can be cooked. It is the most commonly used model for the household cooking. The solar energy converted into heat, which cooks the food without use of cooking gas or kerosene, electricity, coal or wood. And any sunny day, solar cooker can cook two meals per day for 4 to 5 person. Now we have to understand what are the different parts of the solar cooker. So just you see the diagram, there are different parts which are as follows. First is the outer box. Outer box is made of the board, maybe of iron sheet, maybe of fiber reinforced plastic. And there is the inner box. Inner box is made of the galvanized iron, aluminium sheet. And the inner box is coated with the black point. Why it is coated with the black point? Because if it is coated with the black point, thus absorptivity of the solar radiation will be more in inner box, because inner box is a place where container will be placed. So here you must know that the size of inner box is less than the outer box. There is some gap between inner box and outer box, because the wall of inner, there is a space between inner box and outer box, and it will be insulated with the thermal insulation, and this thermal insulation is a glass wool, thermocol, etc. And another part is a double glass cover. Double glass cover, it may be the single glass cover also. Now, what is the use of this glass cover? Through the glass cover, heat is transferred through the glass cover to the inner box of the container, and it is filled with some space, because there is two glass, and it is like a space between these two glass. That means there is air between two glass. So air, you know, air is also work as a insulation. That means whenever heat comes from the sun inside of the container, that means it will be absorbed by the inner box. Now this heat may be transferred through in form of the long wave radiation. If it is a double glass, that means the losses due to the radiation may be reduced. Another is a rubber strip. Rubber strip is used on wooden frame. And next is a mirror. What is the use of mirror? Mirror is used to increase the radiation input on the absorbing surface. And most important part is a cooking container. So this cooking container is made of the aluminium or stainless steel. It is also coated with the black paint on the outside of the container so that it may be able to get the maximum, it may be able to get the absorb the maximum solar radiation in form of the electromagnetic wave. And next is the absorber paint. This paint is used on absorber and outer side of the food container. So these are the component of the box type solar cooker. And this type of solar cooker, in fact, you can make in your home also. For this, what you have to do, just you take two box. This box may be of sweet, this box may be of the shoes, but you have to take care that two boxes, one box should be the smaller, like suppose 30 centimeter by 30 centimeter is the outer box, then you must take the inner box approximately 18 by 18 centimeter. And between these two boxes, you can insulate it by the either by thermocol, or you can also put the straw. You can also put the cotton in between so that the insulation between the inner box and outer box is good, so that the heat may not be transferred from the inner box to the ambient, right? And inside inner box of the container, you can make with help of the packing aluminium foil. What aluminium foil will do? Aluminium will transmit the solar radiation to the container. Now, what are the process of cooking food using a box type solar cooker? First, keep the solar cooker in the sun in open space free from any shadow. Then keep the cooker in the sun at least for 45 minutes before loading it with cooking pots. This will keep the cooker ready for cooking and reduce the cooking time. Adjust the cooker in such a way that reflecting mirror face the sun and the reflected rays fall on the transparent glass lid. Tighten the position, fixing hinge of mirror in this position. Next, open the glass lid of the solar cooker and place the cooking pots inside it and close the lid properly. Once the cooking vessels have been placed inside the cooker, its lid should not be opened. Open the lid fully once the food is cooked. While removing the cooking, you have to take care. Vessel after the food has been cooked, use cloth napkin as the vessels are very hot. You know, the cost of the box solar cooker varies from rupees 1800 to rupees 3000 depending on the size of the feature. The Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, that is MNRE, Government of India, and some state governments are providing financial incentive for ISI mark solar cookers. The another type of solar cooker is concentrator type solar cooker, and this concentrator type solar cooker is used for the community cooking. It works on the principle of solar energy concentration using a reflecting parabolic solar concentrator. A parabolic solar concentrator is used for concentrating solar radiation on a focal area where the cooking vessel is placed. The unique feature of this cooker is that it makes cooking possible with solar energy in the kitchen itself. Like a box type solar cooker, what you have to do, you have to place the box type solar cooker outside of the home or in the open area. But in the concentrated type solar cooker, it is not required. The community solar cooker is useful in the school, institution kitchen, canteens, ashram, hotels, hospitals, police and armed force kitchen. The cost of this cooker is about rupees 50,000, and the payback period is about 4 to 5 years. That means whatever the cost you are incurring for purchasing this concentrator type solar cooker roughly 50,000. That means this 50,000 will be you can save in form of the electrical energy unit save. That means whatever the cook food in electrical solar cooker or due to the gas cooker, that means that amount of that will consume the electricity. Now this food is cooked in this type of solar cooker, that means you are saving amount of unit of electric unit electrical energy, and that cost comes this saving of the electrical energy can be saved into 4 to 5 years. So this is a payback period of solar cooker for the community cooking. Here you can see the parts of the concentrator type solar cooker. First is A, as denoted in the figure part A. This is a solar concentrating disc. It is also called primary reflector. The disc which help in the concentrating solar energy to focal point. Second is an automatic tracking system. What is the requirement of this automatic tracking system? Because you know sun moves from morning to evening or throughout the day. So that means you have to track the this position of this solar concentrating disc according to the sun. So for this automatic tracking system is used. With the help of this simple automatic mechanical tracking system, the solar disc rotates in the direction of the movement of sun to give continuous and accurate solar energy concentrator. And third is secondary reflector. This is provided opening in the north facing wall of the kitchen or the cooking place just below the cooking vessel. This reflector receives the concentrated solar radiation and reflects it on the bottom of the cooking vessel. Basically what happens, like suppose here radiation is coming from the sun, this is a main concentrator and here is a kitchen and this is a secondary reflector. So solar radiation comes on the this particular primary reflector and this reflect to the secondary reflector, and this reflector will be this radiation reflect to the cooking vessel. So that means whatever the solar radiation coming, it will be first will come to the primary reflector, then to the secondary reflector, and then it will be transferred to the cooking vessel. So this is the different parts of the concentrator type solar cooker. Now what are the process of cooking food using a concentrator type solar cooker? So first you have to understand how the installation is done. The solar disc is installed in the open shadow, free area or on terrace top facing south. The cooking place and vessel faces the north at the same ground level. The reflection of the disc falls on the secondary reflector housed in an opening in the north kitchen wall. Now we can understand working of a community solar cooker. Daily in the morning, the disc is manually oriented so as to face the morning sun in the east. The daily orientation action bends the clock mechanism to work throughout the day, and disc start rotating in the direction of the sun guided by the sundial. The cooker begins to work automatically as concentrated solar energy is directed to the cooking vessel. The primary concentrated reflection falls on the secondary reflector, which is placed right below the cooking vessel. The secondary reflector diverts the solar energy on the cooking vessel and the heating begins. Now next is a solar water heater. Solar water heater also work on the principle of solar. That means solar water heating system is a simplest device that uses solar energy to heat water for the domestic, commercial and industrial needs. Heating of water is a most common application of solar energy in the world. A typical solar water heating system can save up to 1500 unit of electricity every year. For every 100 liter per day of solar water heating capacity. Here you can see the simplest solar water heater is built-in storage solar water heater. It mainly consists of following component. First is a rectangular box converted by the glass bowl insulated around the bottom and side walls. Second, one or two glass cover at the top glazing. system work on the principle of greenhouse principle. Here you can see solar radiation coming from the sun, it is transmitted through the glass cover, which is a two layered glass cover. That means the solar radiation comes as a short wave, electromagnetic waves, and then it transferred to the bottom of the this container, and this bottom of the container is coated with the black paint. That means to increase the absorbity of this particular surface. When this heat is absorbed by the solar radiation, that means again this heat will be radiated, and this heat associated at the base of the this storage tank will be transferred to the water. As heat will be transferred to the water, that means this water density of the water will be light. That means water, hot water will go up and cold water will be at the base. So due to the change in the density of the water, this hot water will be go up and hot water can be collected from the hot water outlet. Now we have to understand the different parts of the solar water heater. A solar water heating system consists of a flat plate solar collector and a storage tank capped at height behind the collector and connected pipe. The collector usually comprises copper tubes welded to the copper sheets. Both are coated with the highly absorbing black coating with a toughened glass sheet on top and insulating material in the back. The entire assembly is placed at a flat box. In certain model, evacuated glass tubes are also used instead of copper. A separate copper sheet and insulating box are not required in this case. Here you can understand the working of the solar water heater. The collector are placed on the sun facing side to allow solar radiation to come in. A black absorbing surface, that is called absorber, inside the flat plate collector absorbs solar radiation and transfer the energy to water flowing through it. Heated water is collected in the tank, which is insulated to prevent heat losses. The circulation of water from the tank through the collector and back to the tank continue automatically due to density difference between the hot and cold water. This effect is basically called thermosiphon effect. It is also called natural circulation type of solar water heater, because the flow of the water is due to the natural flow, due to the change in the density of the water. Basically it is called thermosiphon effect. But if you have to increase the capacity of more water heater, that means forced circulation is required. Here you can see the commercial flat plate collector type water heater. Here 5 units of flat water collector are connected in the series. Here there are different type of collector used in the solar water heater. First is flat plate collector. These are the most common type used in the domestic solar water heater system in India, as they are relatively cheaper when compared to other. Second is evacuated tube collector. These have also been proposed for domestic solar water heating system but are not commonly available. And third is a concentrating collector. Concentrating collector are required where high temperature is required. These are likely to be more useful for higher temperature applications such as power generation and industrial use. Here you can see the forced circulation type of solar water water heater. So the difference between natural circulation type of solar water heater pump is using, and this water pumps, because this type of water heater are used where there is a requirement of large amount of hot water. The large number of solar collector is used in series as per the requirement. Now question arises, because you have to use the water pump, that means if you want to switch on the water pump, that means you need to give the external supply from the conventional system, or you can this supply to the pump through the photovoltaic module, right? So if you are giving the power to the water pump by the PV module, so such type of solar water heater will be called hybrid photovoltaic water heater. Here you can see the picture of the hybrid photovoltaic thermal water heater. Here two flat plate collector are used, And here you can see the in the first collector there is some part you are able to see, that is a PV module. This PV module is a transparent PV module. That means some portion of the glass of flat collector is replaced by the PV module. So what is the purpose of this PV module? This PV module is working as a glass. At the same time, it is used to give the power to the motor, and that motor is basically DC motor. So that means if capacity, it is a fractional horsepower motor around 15 watt, and this PV capacity of this PV module is 75 watt. That means 15 watt will be used to operate the DC motor, and which will increase the circulation of the water, and remaining, and the beauty of this hybrid photovoltaic thermal water heater will be what? The remaining PV power generated by the PV module can store in the battery, right? In the whenever this solar PV water is not in use, and this electrical power stored in the battery can be used to switch on the different LED, or at the same time you can use one fan also. So this is a hybrid photovoltaic thermal water heater. Here again you can see the diagram of the hybrid photovoltaic thermal heater. Here three flat plate collector are used, and you require more water, that means number of flat collector are required more. Now because you have to increase the circulation of the water, that means capacity of motor has to be increased. If capacity of motor has to be increased, that means you need a more electrical power. If you need a more electrical power, that means you need to place the more PV module. So here you can see around 10 to 15% of the glass is replaced by the semi-transparent PV module. So this is all about the hybrid photovoltaic thermal collector. There are two or three technologies are remaining, like hybrid PVT air collector and solar steel, and these all remaining solar photovoltaic technology will be discussed in the next lecture. Thank you.